Here's part three of our conversation with Rick Emmett, and we talk about Lay It on the Line. Remember, we made this promise that we would now, when we release a new interview series, we'd also include snippets on this channel and the entire interview on our sister channel, which is Rock History Book. It's on there right now as a podcast, links in the description, and the video of me and Rick talking for, I think, almost 2 hours and 15, 16 minutes is Rick Emmett. Give me some stories, Adam. Lay it on the line.
Okay. Well, I just told a story the other day. I'm going to maybe just grab a little guitar for you here. And I'll tell you a story about Lay It. This is when I told in the Meaford Hall in Meaford, Ontario the other night. So I don't know. Will you be able to hear this guitar?
Mm-hmm.
One of my favorite chords on the guitar is this chord right here. It's an A minor 9. It's pretty, it takes two fingers at the fifth. It's pretty, but I love the way it sits on the guitar. And one of the things that I love about it is that it has this note right, you know, squinched up against this note. So when you hear them out of context, but you go like, that doesn't sound, that's like almost dissonance. They're only a half step away from each other. It's a C note and a B note, but you put it inside the chord. And the chord has this duplicity that I really love, that it's more than one chord, even though you're playing one chord. Now, if you move one finger this way, so that's really what the intro of Lay It on the Line was. It was just, right? That's all it was. But when we get in the studio, and by this is, you know, the story I like to tell is, by the third album, the Just a Game album, I was starting to figure out the difference between being like a kid that was lucky enough to get a recording deal, and then actually being somebody that was living up to this thing that says recording artist. You know, you've signed a contract, and that's what you're calling yourself, but are you really doing the work, you know? And so for me, the work was, yeah, but how can I take this, which in its fundamental way, I find really interesting. I could just do this, but I get a 12-string guitar and I play this voicing. Now, this is a lot harder, right? It's the same thing. It's just, it's a whole different fingering. And when you put this over top of this, so you get two guitars doing it. Oh, now you're actually doing something that's like the recording art, you know. Now, this is just a small, this is the intro of the song. You know, we're not even going to get to the song yet. And the song's going to have this. That's the hook, you know. Lay it on the line. Okay, so this is the story that I told in Meaford, which, do you remember when there was the guy who was doing the lawsuit? He was representing the estate of the Spirit guy that he'd written a tune that was on a Spirit album. And he said, well, Led Zeppelin stole Stairway to Heaven from me. Right. You know,
Randy California. Randy California.
Yeah, exactly. And it had this, but it was the lawyer. Randy California was already dead. This was just a lawyer ambulance chasing, but it had this. Whereas, you know, the Led Zeppelin was. Okay, so anyways, the CBC comes to my house with a cameraman and stuff, and they want they want to know, like, Rick, is this plagiarism? You know, is there anything to this? And I'm going, you know, no, it's ambulance chasing. And I said, look, and I think I even had this very guitar, and I'm sitting on the camera, and I said, okay, chord progressions can't be copyrighted. They're like, that's not one of the ways copyright law works. You know, chord progressions kind of belong to everybody. So I wrote a song, very famous, you know, one of the most successful. And I said, everybody knows it. And they go, hey, it's, yeah, I this is like, yeah, lay it on the line. And I go, yeah, okay, check this out. Rock and roll, hoochie coo. And so the voice goes, ah, Rick stole nothing. I go, no, I didn't steal anything. Like that little thing of chords, that's been used 1,000 times in you know, 1,000 different pop circumstances, you know. But anyways, those are just some of the stories that I can tell about Leia.
Did you hear when I mean, obviously you remembered, but when you're in high school and your English teacher tells you you can write, you got a book in you or whatever, right? See, I've been told that many times, but I just couldn't even, that's like me creating an album because there's so many parts, but you, were you journaling when you were in high school? Did you ever write that down? You obviously remembered it because that's.
Oh yeah. And I had, you know, I can tell you a great little story. I just did a few nights ago. I did, there's a guy named Cameron Smiley, and he does these life artist series things where he sits you down in a soft theater, small situation, intimate, but it's kind of, this is your life. He asks you questions about your career and stuff, and you just tell stories. And I'd done one with him before COVID came in Orillia, Ontario, at the Opera House in Orillia. And at the end, there's a sort of a small Q&A. People from the audience can ask questions. So an old lady got up and she started asking me questions, and she was clearly somebody that knew me from way back, and she had been my English teacher in grade 9 in high school. And she'd married another guy on the faculty there who had been sort of my track coach and my football coach, and he had just recently passed away. So she was grieving, you know, like she was maybe a month after losing her husband, and she's there with her adult kids, and she's come to see me talk, you know, doing one of these speaker things. And it was so moving to get up and go and give her a hug. But she, at one point, you know, she'd said to me, look, you're clearly going to be a writer. You know, don't waste your talents. Like, you have a gift that very few people have, which is not to say that you're anything special. You're not. The gift is special, and you have to respect the gift. So I got tremendous advice from, you know, great people, you know, especially in high school. But you know how life is. You start out in one direction and, you know, like there I am as a high school kid singing folk songs at coffee houses and, you know, playing bastardized versions of Malaguena on that guitar right there. And, you know, but at the same time, I'm a singer in a rock band with my guys, and they know on the weekends we're playing gigs every now and then, and this rock star thing starts to happen. And so now other things are going to get pushed out. So the idea of being a poet or a writer, you know, short stories, prose, like, it never went away. I still always had a little of that because there would be opportunities, you know, in the 80s. It was like, hey, you want to write a column for Guitar Player magazine? I ended up doing that for like 13 years. I wrote for Guitar Player magazine every month. So, you know, and I put my heart and soul into that because I love writing. And not to buff myself too much, but I'm pretty good at it. So, you know, I like to write. I don't care what it is. You know, I like being creative. As I've said in some other interviews recently, when I got asked to be on the a committee at Humber for curriculum, I was happy to do it because I said, no, I don't need to get paid or anything. I'm happy to do it because it's creative. You're actually, here's a set of problems. Yeah. You know, can you sort of take this thing from your left brain and this thing from your right brain and this thing from his brain and put them together in a way that it solves a problem? And I love that kind of stuff. I love being creative. So the writing of poetry came to me in the last chapter of my life. It's a good chapter so far.
We'll have more from Rick Emmett in 3-4 days. Make sure you comment on our video, subscribe to our channel, and share our videos. Buy a t-shirt, help support the channel. I'm John Bowden. This is Rock History Music.